welcome to our last meeting of the 2017 year. Our last meeting now. Unfortunately, our wonderful president can't be here, so I'll be running the meeting. So let's get going. The second item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes for the October 17th meeting.
I move we approve the minutes.
Second.
Okay. All in favor? All opposed? Okay. Is there any council discussion for the agenda?
Might have been presented.
All right. Action item number four, the proposed stipulation in the matter of Joseph Kuba. Hello.
Good morning. Happy holidays, commissioners. My name is Sergio Perez, the Director of Enforcement for the Ethics Commission, and I'm joined by the investigator who worked up the case related to item four, Michael Lowden. Good morning.
Good morning. Can you guys just give us a high-level summary of why the recommendation of the stipulation is what it is?
Certainly, as detailed both in the item cover memo and in the proposed stipulation and exhibit, the respondent in this matter, Mr. Joseph Kuba, has agreed that he made 8 contributions to 4 committees, including 2 city council committees and 2 officeholder committees, that resulted in an excess contribution. The proposed penalty in this case is $15,000. And that represents 50% of the maximum charge penalty, which reflects Mr. Kuba's cooperation during the investigation.
Great. Do any of my fellow commissioners have comments?
Yes, I crunched the numbers on this, and I hate crunching numbers, so. It's 50,000, is that, I'm assuming that's 37.50 for each violation, because it's not really spelled out.
Commissioner Murray, if you take a look at the penalty section of the stipulation and exhibit, and that is on page 6 of the item, we do run down the equation that we use for the penalty. In this case, the maximum charge penalty is 20,000. That's 5,000 for each of the 4 counts. Mr. Kuba does get a reduction, but there is another factor that comes into play, and that is his past enforcement history. So he does end up, has agreed to pay 75% of the maximum penalty, which comes out, as you stated, to the amount per count.
Okay. I'm just wondering, maybe there should be a paragraph added just to clarify.
Definitely, Commissioner Murray. We'll definitely take that into account, and we will hope that you see that reflected. Oh, we will ensure that you see that reflected in future enforcement actions.
That's it.
Okay.
Sure, maybe along those lines, since this is a new process, so maybe you can share more on the factors that go into the arrival of the penalty. I know there's a administrative
law,
maybe you can share some more on that, particularly what would amount to cooperation.
Commissioner Campos, the factors that we use in arriving at the penalty, as were discussed in the enforcement practices memo, with which you all considered at our last commission meeting, are based, as you stated, on the admin code, the city's charter language, which details not only the powers of the Ethics Commission with regards to its investigations and enforcement actions, but also the penalties that it can bring to bear. The factors that we take into account in assessing penalties are laid out in the administrative law code, and they include, I'll just give you a brief summary here, the severity of the violation, whether the violation was deliberate, or whether there was an intent to conceal, whether the violator demonstrated good faith by contacting Ethics Commission staff before taking an action, whether the violation was an isolated incident or part of a pattern, and the degree to which the violator cooperated. A cooperation can mean a lot of different things throughout the life of an investigation. It's never pegged to a decision not to assert rights that are available during an investigation. Meaning, I'll give you an example. If we issue a subpoena and the individual believes that we have issued a subpoena that is not supported by the law or by the declaration attached to that subpoena, we would never say that that individual is not cooperating by seeking to assert his or her rights in that process. What it does mean is prompt and complete responses to requests for documents and information, full and a frank engagement with our investigation. And I'll give you an example. There are times when we, and this is general and it has nothing to do with this item, this is just a general backdrop. There are times when we will request information from the target of an investigation. And we will receive a response, but after we take other investigative steps, it will be clear that that response was incomplete. And that is an example of a lack of cooperation. Generally speaking, if we ask you for emails from August 1st to August 15th, you provide us 5, and then we ask other people for that same period of emails, and they provided us 10, and it's clear that you had those emails because you received those emails or sent those emails, then that's a sign of a lack of cooperation. So that's, a specific enough example.
That's very helpful.
And finally, apart from cooperation, the overall interest of justice. And this is meant to reflect the importance of the laws that we enforce here and the goals that we are seeking to obtain through our enforcement of the laws, which is a transparent government and a government whose actions reflect a serious commitment to fairness and equal treatment.
I don't think this is more of a comment than a question. It does seem to me that staff has given us more information based upon the commission's request, and I really appreciate it. The only possible confusion is that in paragraph on the penalty, in paragraph 2, the enforcement staff uncovered no evidence of an intent to conceal or deceive by Kugler. And then obviously that would be an affirmative finding. But it also says that there is a prior record of violations with the Ethics Commission. Are those two consistent?
They are, because the statement that precedes the reference to a prior enforcement history is limited completely to the actions that underlie the violations alleged here. Meaning the prior enforcement history does not immediately mean that the individual who acts later on is doing so with an intent. And I would reiterate that we didn't find any indication here that there was an intent to violate the law.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Seeing no public comment, I think that this is really seems very fair. Thank you so much for being so thorough. And I move to approve the stipulation in the matter of Joseph Kuba with a penalty of $15,000.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Seeing none. Motion approved.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Day up here for the next issue item, which is a proposed stipulation in the matter of Ingrid Lee.
Okay. Commissioners, this is me again, I'm joined by Senior Investigator Stephen Cohen, who worked up the investigation at issue.
And so again, maybe you can just give us, for the public and for ourselves, a brief summary.
Certainly. Item 5 relates to a proposed stipulation involving 11 contributions to 4 separate committees, which included 3 city council committees and 1 office holder committee, which resulted in an excess contribution of $3,870. The proposed penalty, predicated on 5 counts, is $16,455, and I recommend that you approve the stipulation.
Does anyone have any comments?
I would just say that again, you have shown here the difference between, in one case, going 3/4 of the penalty. Here you're going approximately a half of the penalty, and I think you've explained your reasons.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Commissioner.
Okay, I make a motion to approve.
Great.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you. It's a present if you're not there.
One more, this time I'm solo.
So, the next item on our agenda is a notice of inactive investigations. We had a pretty in-depth conversation about this, I believe it was at the last meeting, about how and if to notify people should an investigation become inactive. And this is the recommendation of the commission, maybe you can talk about this.
This item, as you stated, Vice President Overstein, reflects an ongoing conversation that we have had regarding the kinds of notice that we provide to the targets of investigations when those investigations have gone inactive. The item recommends a verbal notice, and we believe that will address the concerns that have been articulated in the past by respondents while ensuring the integrity of the work that the Ethics Commission does.
I just want to say how excited I was to see this on the agenda. You know, after the numerous conversations that we have had, and in the spirit of transparency that the Ethics Commission represents, I think that people will be very, very appreciative. I think that, you know, a verbal notice keeps us from having to get sort of muddy with the Public Records Act. But I appreciate the willingness to hear the commissioners and to come to this conclusion. So I'm very excited about it. I don't know if my fellow commissioners want to weigh in.
Well, we all talked about it at some length before, the concern of not knowing and not being able to be comfortable, and since so many other enforcement agencies are much more formal and will actually do a press release or a notice. I think, given all the factors that you have weighed, this is a good, at least beginning for transparency. There's also the possibility, I think, of having a written notice, perhaps only if and only there is a request from the person. But I think the present plan, at least as a beginning, is a good one.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just say, I guess I wonder if people request something in writing, does that are we able to do something that's inconsistent? Like it would seem inconsistent, and then that we should have one mechanism for notifying everybody.
I don't think we have to decide it.
Okay. All right. Great. Does anyone else want to comment?
No. I'm sorry. I wanted to thank the staff for, we've been talking about this for a long time. And I think this policy is a good balancing, and it protects the confidentiality of the process, but also provides transparency. So there's a need for environment.
Just wondering if there was any public comment.
There isn't. No, only on issue item number 8. Lots.
Then I'll let go with everyone else.
So the recommendation is that approving the language, which is to say that should an investigation. Why don't I read it? That there be verbal notice when an issue item or an investigation become inactive, and that the commission vote to approve that. Do I have a motion?
I move to approve.
I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Happy holidays, and I won't see you, so happy new year.
Thank you. Our next item on the agenda is the recusal of the president of the Board of Water and Power, Mel Levine. Hello.
Good morning.
Mr. Harrington, do you want to just stop right now?
Sure. As you're aware, members of city boards and commissions are required to submit recusal forms each time they recuse themselves due to an actual or apparent conflict of interest. The city charter requires the ethics commission to conduct a review if they meet the threshold number of recusals in a 365 day period. President Levine of the DWP commission recused himself 21 times during the review period. They were all due to his position, income, and retirement income as he's of counsel at Gibson Dunn Law Firm. So these were financial interests that he recused himself from. During the review period, he did participate in 96% of all matters that came before the board. So staff is recommending that no divestment be ordered and that there is no continuing or significant conflict of interest.
I move to approve.
I second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Great.
Thank you. I know our agenda item 8 is the municipal lobbying ordinance. I also know that Commissioner Campos is going to have to recuse herself from that. So before we begin to talk about that, I'd like to look at action item number 9, the regular meeting schedule, and we'll talk about if that works for everybody and vote. Well, we have has everybody taken a look? Meeting schedule work. Great.
I mean, right now it all works, right?
Absolutely. These days, December 18th. Okay, so I move to approve the 2018 meeting schedule.
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Amen. All right. Action item number 9. Which is the municipal lobbying ordinance.
Right. Oh, you're right. That's
good information.
Okay. Sorry.
Okay.
No, wait,
we switched the
agenda. Commissioner Campos, I hope you have a wonderful holiday and maybe get to have some solace and take a break and relax, get some pedicures or whatever it is that you do that brings you solace.
Thank you. Likewise. Good luck.
Thank you so much.
Sorry.
So as I mentioned, there's a lot of public comment. In getting to agenda item number 8, the municipal lobbying ordinance, why don't we start with public comment? Kent Minolt from the Sierra Club, would you like to come up, sir?
Thanks for the opportunity to address this important issue. I'm Kent Minow, and I've been volunteering with the Sierra Club on environmental and energy issues for over 8 years. And I work frequently with allied organizations like Scope in South LA, the Unión de Vecinos, and the Watts Clean Air Group, which I sit on. And I'm here to say that it would certainly be unethical and undemocratic to throw obstacles in the way of the most vulnerable of our citizens in participating in our democracy. And that's what might happen if this committee treats nonprofits advocating for environmental and economic justice the same way that they treat for-profit organizations advocating for their own economic interests. If indeed it's necessary to monitor the advocacy of nonprofits and their volunteers like me, might this committee give an exemption to smaller community-oriented nonprofits with a smaller budget and less capacity to shoulder bureaucratic burdens so that the voices of those who most need to petition government are free from onerous and intimidating reporting requirements? Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Nona Randoy? Yes.
Good morning. It's Nora Randois.
Don't worry about it, thank you. Good morning, happy holidays. My name is Nona Randois, and I'm the California Director for the Alliance for Justice. Thank you for this opportunity to comment on the proposed revisions to the nonprofit exemption to the municipal lobbying ordinance. Alliance for Justice is a national nonprofit committed to progressive values and the creation of an equitable, just, and free society. In our Boulder Advocacy Program, we're the leading expert on the legal framework for nonprofit advocacy efforts, providing free information, resources, and technical assistance to encourage nonprofit organizations to fully exercise their rights to be active participants in the democratic process. We're not a law firm, but we provide support to nonprofit organizations to empower them to advocate in line with their missions and in compliance with the law. Since 2004, we've worked with over 1,800 small, medium, and large nonprofit organizations in California. The current municipal lobbying ordinance already treats 501c3s differently. We're asking today that the exemption be made clearer and more useful. So we've provided an option 5 for your consideration. I have extra copies of this if anyone else needs one. It's the same language from our letter, which is part of the packet that you have in the back. Compared to options 1 and 2, option 5 is clearer in several ways. It uses plain language. It adds types of assistance that 501c3s may provide to the exempt. It clarifies exactly when the exemption does not apply. And it does not include the confusing limitation that employees and board members must be engaged in providing direct basic life assistance to be exempt. When is someone both engaged in providing direct basic life assistance and also attempting to influence a city matter? This phrase alone could render the nonprofit exemption unusable. We further clarify the exemption by adding an option to be exempted based on size. This would help smaller charities that feel uncomfortable in knowing whether the terms direct services or direct basic life assistance apply to them without having to hire an attorney. For smaller organizations, an easy-to-use size-based exemption is critical to allow them to participate in city decision-making. We urge you to choose option 5. Thank you, and happy holidays.
Thank you, Ms. Randall. Christopher Hommenberg.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for the opportunity to comment on the Commission's review of the LA MLO. My name is Chris Hommenberg, and I'm a fellow with Public Counsel in Austin. Public Counsel is a nonprofit firm that provides free legal services to disadvantaged individuals and nonprofit organizations that serve them in LA County. Both Public Counsel and our nonprofit clients engage in lobbying and other advocacy with the City of LA on behalf of disadvantaged individuals, many of whom are underrepresented in the city's decision-making process. These individuals stand to lose meaningful access to this process without nonprofit lobbying and advocacy. Public Counsel believes that applying an additional level of monitoring to nonprofits is unnecessary and that for-profit entities are unlikely to create 501c3s for the purpose of using the exemption. Numerous government authorities already oversee and regulate 501c3s, and such organizations must be operated for a charitable or educational purpose rather than one of private benefit. If a for-profit were to create an entity for advancing business interests, it would likely be tax-exempt as a 501c6 or as a 501c3 private foundation that is effectively prohibited from lobbying. Moreover, 501c3s face the risk of revocation of their tax-exempt status if they engage in impermissible campaigning activity. The proposed exemption will impose burdens that threaten to create a chilling effect that will reduce participation of disadvantaged city residents in critical decision-making processes. Given this danger and the extensive oversight already in place, we encourage the Commission to implement the following. First, we ask that the Commission broaden the proposal's 501c3 exemption to include all nonprofit organizations exempt under 501c3 of the Internal Revenue Code, whose primary purpose is to provide assistance to low-income people for free or at below market rates. Second, we ask that the commission remove the requirement for government funding from the proposed exemption. This requirement will arbitrarily force many small nonprofits that do not receive government funding to shift more resources to administration. At a time when government funding is in decline, this requirement raises serious concerns of the future advocacy efforts of numerous nonprofits that are in danger of losing access to this funding. Thank you again for this opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Hamilton. Sham Subramanian.
Good morning, Sham Subramanian, Southern California Council with Alliance for Justice. Thank you to the commission and to staff for their time and attention to the issues of importance to nonprofit organizations in the city. We support option five for a few reasons. First, staff will say that they have proposed to increase the threshold for registering as a lobbyist. However, under recommendations the Ethics Commission has approved, the indirect lobbyist threshold, reporting for grassroots advocacy, has been lowered. An organization will be required to register as an indirect lobbyist, pay a $450 registration fee, and file reports every 2 months if it spends $5,000 or more in a calendar year lobbying, even if no one from the organization directly communicates with a city official. Groups that engage disadvantaged residents in city decision-making or inform them about pending city matters will be required to register and report earlier than under current law. And that's because the current threshold for major filers is $5,000 in a calendar quarter, and major filers are not required to register. That threshold has been lowered. Second, staff's proposal, option number one, will be more confusing for 501c3s as compared to option five. First, the proposal says the exemption does not apply to other action by the organization, but does not clarify exactly what other action means, just provides a few examples. Second, by saying basic life assistant means, as opposed to basic life assistance includes, staff excludes many organizations that would be exempt under current law, which does not define direct services 501c3s must provide to be exempt. I also want to echo the comment previously made that it's not clear why staff has included the requirement that 501c3s receive government funding in order to be exempt. So we believe that option five both protects an exemption for organizations that provide direct assistance, as well as smaller organizations with the SAS cap. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Superman. Greg Spiegel.
Hi, Greg Spiegel, Inner City Law Center. We're concerned that the text of this proposed ordinance is open to extremely broad interpretations and would capture activities that is not lobbying and as a result would chill public participation in the government process. As such, I ask that before you launch this draft out of committee, you really discuss it, so to speak. Get members of the public to provide with 5 to 10 factual scenarios, and together we can test them against the text to see where they come out. I started doing that when it became clear or unclear where you may go with nonprofits. Let me highlight one area of concern. As you know, an indirect lobbyist is a category required to register and report under the draft ordinance. But did you know that according to the text, someone could be an indirect lobbyist without ever communicating anything to any city employee or indeed anyone? According to the text, a person can attempt to influence simply by gathering information about a city matter that they have a position about. Once one has attempted to influence, one becomes an indirect lobbyist simply by earning or incurring $5,000 worth of expenses while doing so. That means if someone with a salary of $60,000 per year spends a month of work collecting data on the lack of public toilets in Skid Row with the notion that there should be more public toilets, something I and many Skid Row residents and nonprofit colleagues have done recently. According to the text, that is an indirect lobbyist, even if no one ever shares the information with anyone. Simply gathering that information while earning or incurring expenses of $5,000 is enough, even if one never shares that information with anyone. And that $5,000 benchmark that separates a lobbyist from a non-lobbyist violates the stated principle that this ordinance treats everyone the same. Under the $5,000 standard, two people can do the exact same activity for the same amount of time for the same reason, and one could be a lobbyist and the other not, simply because one gets paid less than the other. This is not treating people the same. And because one could be a lobbyist based on incurring expenses of $5,000 in a year, just incurring expenses, one could be categorized as a lobbyist even if one never receives any payment for the activity and indeed has no financial interest in the outcome. Among your responsibilities as our commissioners is to assess, is to assess the actual text of the law you're proposing, not simply staff's interpretation of it. And right now, I think the text is different than how you and staff talk about it. To prevent some of these outcomes before you launch, please work with the community in a series of small groups, sitting around a table, to beta test some factual scenarios against the text. Thank you.
Michelle Pritchard.
Good morning, commissioners. My name is Michelle Pritchard, and I'm the director of the Common Agenda Program at the Liberty Hill Foundation, which was founded in 1976 to advance equity and social justice in the Los Angeles region. And we do this by funding and supporting grassroots community-based organizations working to serve and advance the rights of the most vulnerable and disadvantaged in our city, from immigrants to low-wage workers to high-risk youth to neighbors living next to polluting facilities and land uses. We are concerned that the current proposal will have a confusing and dampening effect on the advocacy work of these groups. Without them, as one of the speakers referenced already, there are just huge segments of the city and population groups that would go underrepresented without their voices heard on key public policy issues. All of the nonprofits that we support have demonstrated to the IRS that their work is charitable and educational in order to gain their 501c3 status. And they are all responsible, as you've heard from others, for tracking and reporting lobby hours to the IRS and staying within specified limits. We think that the LAMLO and proposed changes will create a burden for nonprofits, most of whom are small and struggling and lack the administrative and financial systems to track multiple definitions of lobbying and to file numerous reports and pay additional fees. So we would like to support option 5, developed by the nonprofit community, including Liberty Hill, the Alliance for Justice, Cal Nonprofits, the Center for Nonprofit Management, which has been tracking this issue for the last year and a half. We think that the proposal for a size cap of $2.5 million is a reasonable compromise that maintains the commission's charge to protect the public's right to know, with the nonprofit sector's mission to serve and advocate for disadvantaged communities without significant regulatory or administrative burden. We also strongly support and urge the maintenance of exemption for nonprofits providing direct services and life assistance with the revised and more precise language in option 5. Thank you.
Aquilina Versosa.
Good morning, I'm Aquilina Versosa, the Executive Director of the Filipino Workers Cemetery. I'm also here representing my nonprofit to support the option 5 that has been proposed. We are a small nonprofit that is growing, and we're one of the few organizations that is serving low-wage Filipino workers and their families, and especially those who are domestic workers, and many of them are live-in workers. And it's our role in terms of helping to support and bring their voices and their experiences to policymaking in the city, we feel is very important. And the current proposed staff proposal would put up different challenges that especially ethnic-specific smaller organizations, it would actually put a lot of burden and challenges to be able to bring the voices of these, like our diverse community here to the city. For many years, we did not have government funding as we were growing as an organization. A lot of times that's about capacity, not about the actual work that you're doing and the assistance that you're providing. And it's important that we take out that removing the government funding requirement, I think is a big obstacle that needs to be put out, and the clear language, and not putting the burden of really needing to have extra attorney to and filing requirements, because we're already trying to serve these growing needs in our communities, and then adding this extra bureaucracy to small nonprofits really would put a big extra burden on us. And we feel that it's very important that we have all of these voices brought to policymaking, and that option five would, balance, the need for transparency and the charge that you have, plus the needs of our nonprofit, and for good policymaking. Thank you.
Thanks. Nicole Wong, Redeemer Community Partnership.
Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity. My name's Nicole Wong. I'm the lead community organizer with Redeemer Community Partnership. We're a Christian community development corporation that's been working in Exposition Park in South LA since 1992. Our focus is creating a network of programs and partners that will support children in our neighborhood from birth to college and career. And a big part of reaching that vision involves advocacy and public policy around enhancing modes of active transportation and environmental justice needs in South LA. And we primarily work alongside low-income, working-class community of color. And I just want to share an example of someone in my neighborhood that I work with. Lillian has lived in the neighborhood for over 40 years. She lives three houses down from an active oil drilling site. She has suffered from seeing her son have spontaneous nosebleeds. She's lost two neighbors to cancer, and her husband right now has cancer eating away at his lungs. She's tried complaining, getting involved in the public process over many decades, often feeling unheard. When I first met her, she had just a sense of hopelessness around whether anything could be done to correct this environmental injustice. But it's because of some of the work and connections that we've been able to bring her into, she's become one of the strongest advocates on her street. She brings along all these older, retired women who are Spanish-speaking to come to the public meetings and hearings, and their voice and their perspective in these meetings have been really key to moving forward some of the advocacy work that has happened. We've been able to win stronger protections around this oil drilling site. Some of our other work, including securing $6.4 million for streetscape improvements and safety in our neighborhood, is because of people like Lillian. Serving low-income, underrepresented, and marginalized communities is the bottom line for nonprofit communities. And rules that make it more expensive, complex, and risky will mean these people who are so critical to this process will participate less in city decision-making processes. So we really urge the commission to choose option five. We really believe that it will allow us to easily understand whether or not we're exempt. We shouldn't have to hire an attorney and spend more expenses to figure this out. And so we just really urge you to choose option five. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Wong. Daryl Gale.
Hello, I'm Daryl Gale. I'm also a volunteer with numerous environmental and environmental justice organizations. So because I'm a retired senior, I just do this as much as I can at this stage of my life. I often lobby or testify at City Hall or at neighborhood councils, at the AQMD, with like the Sierra Club, Food and Water Watch, Stand LA, and other organizations. Also, I am very much, my main interests are air and water pollution, and it just seems like all these, you know, neighborhoods or areas of the city or whole swaths of the city are very much burdened by large oil companies, oil and gas companies usually, and it's just giving, you know, all this extra paperwork for these organizations is just more of an onerous burden to them. They're, you know, I'm usually working with young people in their 20s and 30s. They're working, you know, like 16 hours a day, and I hate to see them having more of a burden, and because I feel like we're fighting, you know, really, really large corporations. So I just hope you consider that when you're in your rulemaking. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to mess this up. Dagan Bayless.
Good morning. This has been general work, so if I'm a few comprehensible, it's because my face is numb. I'm the director of organizing at SAGE in South Los Angeles, and we work on housing and land use issues in a community largely immigrant working families and very low income. And our model is to address the individual needs to an extent, but it is very different people need a public dialogue. We see that it's important to address to give people the opportunity to have a voice in the decisions that are made about the shape of the community that takes in the future. What we hope for is that we can create better neighborhoods where the same neighbors can remain. And in order for us to do this, we need to, our objective is that people will be able to speak for themselves in the public meetings, with the media, or directly in some cases to decision makers in the public sector as well as the private sector. So that is effectively a lobbying function, but in my mind, it deviates from the notion of a lobbyist as a white man in a suit and tie and briefcase. These are people who are speaking from their own experience in a way which I feel is very healthy for them. I feel that there's a kind of collateral rippling benefit that people experience being able to directly confront major challenges in their lives and then speak about that to the people who are able to adjust the system so that other people can experience a benefit. So we support option 5. Of course, there has to be accountability, but we're SAGE and organizations in our space are operating on tight budgets, low salaries, we have a limited capacity to deal with extra administrative tasks. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Wheeler. Eric Roman. Terry Dolan.
Good morning, Commissioners. Eric Roman, the coordinator of Standing Together Against Neighborhood Drilling. We're an environmental justice coalition representing 7 different community-based nonprofit organizations that work principally in South Los Angeles and in Wilmington. And our focus is on ending the problem of urban and neighborhood drilling, which is a significant health harm to principally low-income communities of color who live fence line to these facilities. The broader context that we work in is one in which, at the federal level and also at the state level, the oil and gas industry, perhaps the most powerful lobbying force in the country, has already significant influence over public policy, such that winning protections for communities from the effects of their facilities is already very difficult. The rules proposed by staff here would create additional barriers for community residents and the organizations that work with them to have their voices heard, to be able to effectively counter the power and the financial might of the oil and gas industry. People like Don Martin, an African-American gentleman who lives in a low-income housing facility right next to an oil drilling site in South Los Angeles on West Adams Boulevard, whose granddaughter suffered from cancer. There's countless stories like that, and the work of the organizations, the nonprofit organizations and the advocates to facilitate the voices of community residents to be able to advocate and inform public policy is critical. Moreover, organizations that consciously limit their own activity in public policy debates because of these rules and would limit them further because of additionally onerous rules is very detrimental to public policy making in the public interest, right? When I hear of organizations who consciously decide not to attend public hearings, including this one, because they're concerned about the rules, the impact on public policy, sound public policy and public policy that protects public interest and public health is significant. So urge you to support option 5 that's on the table. Thank you.
So there are two potential items to vote on, since no one made public comment without direct communication. I would suggest that we start with the second issue.
I think they didn't talk directly about direct communications, but by commenting a great deal about indirect I think it's still the right order.
That it seems that there's greater interest in discussing how this could potentially affect the nonprofit community. So maybe we should start with that stipulation. Mr. Tarzi, did you want to?
Sure. First of all, happy holidays to everyone. Thank you to everyone who has provided both written and in-person comments, not only today, but throughout this nearly two-year process. This comprehensive review has been spanning that long, believe it or not. And
not for all of us.
We approved the vast majority of the recommendations at the last meeting in October, at least two specific recommendations remaining. The direct disclosure of the communications with city officials and the 501c3 exemption. We made a strong effort to provide you, the commissioners, with several options on these two remaining issues. I cannot emphasize enough that these do not represent an exhaustive list of the possibilities, but they can be modified to whichever way you wish to make them, and that staff is here ready to assist you in that process. With regard to the 501c3 exemption, staff originally proposed expanding the exemption by removing the requirement of receiving government funding solely for the purpose of representing indigent clients and not requiring services be free of charge. I've heard some comments stating today that this would be a detriment. These laws are already in place. We're actually working to expand them in this form. Additionally, there are approximately 15 exemptions to the definition of direct communication. And for example, we heard a comment today about nonprofit representatives coming to public meetings and providing testimony. All that under the proposal would not lead towards the threshold for registering. Option two is an alternative to option one, and it just basically ties in a more objective standard by using the county and HUD numbers. Option three is a monetary and size-based exemption that's part of the suggestion of the nonprofit from the nonprofit community. And finally, option four is also a size-based approach, but one that has actual footing in the type of IRS forms filed by nonprofits. And it's already in practice in a similar size jurisdiction. San Francisco's 501c3 exemption is based on the Form 990N and the Form 990EZ. And if I can, just briefly, I'll just touch on the communications. Those options, option one consists of staff's original recommendation. The lobbying entities disclose direct communications with city employees by specifying the date of communication, the employee's title, the division, and agency. Option two and three are alternatives that were discussed at the last meeting in October that narrow the level of official that should be disclosed to either high-level city officials or elected department heads and board and commission members. We've had numerous interested persons meetings, written comments, in-person comments. This is now our fifth public meeting on this item. So we hope that these options assist you, commissioners, in making the decision on these remaining two issues, and we're happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. Do you just want to introduce yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry, that's my fault. I'm joined by my colleague, Mark Lowe, the lobbying program manager.
And to all the citizens greeting, I'll just add Baha.
Okay, great. I think we should start the conversation, but I also want to just say that because we're down to commissioners, if we don't have a unanimous vote, then we won't be able to move forward today, and we may have to revisit this in February. So that could be fun. Well, I'll start by saying, Mr. Tarzi, I do appreciate you making the distinction that the staff is working to expand the current language, and not to sort of limit. And I know that the commissioners also feel like, or I'll say from my perspective, I appreciate wanting to expand the language to ensure that the right balance is struck in protecting nonprofits who, I think, you know, they are not nonprofits, 501c3s, and lobbying organizations are not similarly situated organizations. Lobbyists are mostly, if not always, for-profit organizations acting in their own interests. And as so many of the people who gave public comment today reminded us of the people who are not necessarily providing direct services to disadvantaged people, but things like advocacy for environmental justice or access to transportation or access to you know, not living in a food desert, you know, which I think under a lot of this language, those organizations would not be protected. So, you know, there, I think we are presented with a lot of good options. I do appreciate in option five, the item number one that clarifies and sort of refines from the legalese that we've been using to something that is not in, you know, 24th grade, so that a nonprofit coming in wouldn't have to consult with a lawyer. I think there is a good clarification in that one. And as I've said at previous meetings, you know, I do think looking at gross receipts or some type of budgetary function for the exemption, I don't think that we need to have a blanket exemption, but some type of exemption based on budget and size does make a lot of sense to me. And so maybe it's 2 million, maybe it's something else, but I wanted to just start the conversation there.
I will go next. Can you hear me? Okay. I'm really excited about this process. I know we've been dealing with these issues for 2 years and a lot of discussion and a lot of back and forth. But every time we do have a meeting, I'm very excited and encouraged by the comment that we're getting from not only the lobbying firms, but also our nonprofits who try to make the city better. So I'm really excited. I read all of, and I'm sure all the commissioners have read all of the letters and communications. And we really, I just want to say on behalf of the commission, we really do appreciate it. And it is extremely helpful to get input from the community. As is no secret, I've stated in the past that I actually didn't have a problem with a blanket exception. However, realistically and taking in input, I do feel that the option provided in option five, both with regards to providing assistance that does not necessarily consider government funding, is very good. And I also do agree with the second part of having gross receipts of less than 2.5 million is a good compromise. And if we could come to a consensus, I would agree with option five with regards to the lobbying as currently stated. I'd like to hear more input from my commissioners, not only with that, but especially as to the, I know we're kind of ping-ponging back and forth, but as to the direct communications, because I believe that Commissioner Ordon did have a good position that I was leaning toward the last time we spoke, but, and I'm thinking that's more along the option three of direct communication, but Commissioner, if you could, Ordon, if you could clarify that.
On going to the disclosure of the direct, you know, I was worried about last time. I'm worried about the fact that there are so many employees, and there's always the worry about getting names wrong and right, and many people do not have cards. What you want is something that really will tell the public and the people who are opposing on the other side where the communications are taking place. So the problem with three is it sounds as if these are the only ones that, you know, you're really worried about. And My worry there is, as one of the comments that was made, is that hopefully with the real decision maker, or the one that only needs to be turned around, is going to be much further down in the organization chart than elected official department heads. So it's where is it occurring? High level city official, the problem with that is it's in the eye of the beholder. And so, you know, and when you go to employee, that's pretty easy, but that seems over inclusive. So it's not an easy one, but I think I understand why staff went to original recommendation. If you have the division and title, I'm still leaning more toward having the employee one. I think the others are not inclusive enough. Now, it was interesting. Today, I think we've gotten the most concrete bringing together of all of the organizations in terms of where it is, and even if it's taken 2 years, maybe it'll take another 6 months for this one, but it has been a useful a process. It has been a useful process, and so at the moment I'm still on option one. If staff, even sitting here right this moment, can think of a way of narrowing one at all. I mean, obviously you've put a lot of thought in it to get to option two or three. Is it maybe the title, or maybe just the title without having the employee's name? You know, have you got a thought about making this more inclusive than two or three, but not precisely one?
So none of these proposals require the name of the city official. They all require the title.
They all
require the title. For option two, we kind of tie in, and we say this in the memo, we tie in 49513 C1, which is in our governmental ethics ordinance, which lists several specific positions. But those positions in that section of law is not inclusive to other positions like commissions or other board members. It also doesn't include, you know, department directors. So, you know, maybe that, if that's what the commission is leaning towards, maybe expanding that list to include, obviously, commissioners, board members, department and division directors, managers, and maybe their deputies as well, if you're kind of looking for something in between those two.
So are you suggesting high-level city official, which triggers Municipal Code 49.513, and adding department head, board, or commission member? Is that
right? Yeah. So using 49.513 mm-hmm. as a base, and mm-hmm. then adding the positions that are missing. And then, for example, if you're a commission board members, if we're looking for more activity that's happening lower, it could be the department or division director or manager, whatever the equivalent is, and we could even add deputies if we're trying to get those senior type officials.
If I could offer another suggestion. Good morning, Heather Holt, Executive Director. Happy holidays. One way that we distinguish among all of the people on city payroll is with the term of city officials. This mostly applies in terms of the governmental ethics laws, and it means people who file a Form 700. That is an objective way to get at about 6,000 decision makers in the city, short of the 40,000 that exist, about 40,000. It would require some effort on the part of the people making the disclosure to determine whether somebody is a Form 700 filer, but in the course of a meeting, they could conceivably ask you to file Form 700 and hopefully the person would know. There are pluses and minuses to that approach, but that is one way to more objectively identify the kinds of people as a middle ground that should be disclosed.
That's a great idea. I'm definitely open to modifying to say that, well, I guess, I mean, division title would apply to commissioners and board members, correct? Right? I think that that's a really good suggestion, and it gets at.
And you don't, you would not have to use the word high level, because city official is defined.
It is defined, and we could refer, we could add that definition and refer specifically to the definition in the governmental ethics ordinance.
Okay. Is everybody comfortable with that?
Yes, I am.
Are you? Okay, so. I move to modify, I think it would probably be option two, and swap out.
Recognizing when you do this, we're doing this across the board too, right? We are saying across the board, not just for nonprofits, that the direct community, this is for everyone. Is that what we want to do too?
Well, I think the disclosure of direct communication will, when we talk about if an exemption, then we'll determine who this actually applies to. Is that accurate? Or will any person, whoever?
But the corporate advocate, and I, since everyone seems to hate the word lobbyist, I'm going to start moving into advocate, because I really do think that the pejorative nature of lobbyists really shouldn't be, I mean, whether you're a nonprofit or a corporate entity, people are putting forth their views in order to assist the city to represent the people. So I wish that the pejorative side of it was not emphasized. But if we're talking about defining disclosure of direct communications, that's the definition across the board, right?
Yes, it's for people who are defined as lobbying entities.
Right. So I'm just saying, by going to option two, we're making a change. I want to be sure that everyone in the room and in the commissioners realize we're making that change for everyone. And do we feel part of the reason we're in the nonprofit area is we are concerned about, I hope, not just the substance, because that would be, I think, improper, but we're concerned about the fact that they're advocating and, more as citizens without the resources, and we don't want that type of interference with speech. So if we redefine disclosure of direct communications in option two, that's a definition that will apply for our corporate advocates as well.
Right, so depending on what the commission agrees on with the 501c3 exemption, what is a 501c3 doesn't meet the exemption, you will decide, hopefully today. If the 501c3 doesn't meet that requirement and they register with us, depending if they're a lobbying organization, then yeah, this would be in the disclosure reports requirement. So it would be for lobbyists, for lobbying firms and lobbying organizations, and to a different degree, indirect lobbyists. But it would be basically, that would be the threshold. If you are required to register and you do have that activity, it would be on your disclosure report.
Yeah. Okay. Can we vote separately?
Yes.
Okay, great. So I motion to adopt option two with a slight modification to read, lobbying entities must disclose each direct communication by identifying the date, the agency, and the division and title of each person filing a Form 700. Is that?
Each city official.
Okay, but great. Each city official filing a Form 700. Do I have a second?
We don't even have to say the 700, do we?
No, because there's two different bodies of law. So if we only have to amend the definition once in order to cover the bases, simply referring to the definition in the other law will be sufficient, and it will evolve with time.
So city official triggers. It's like municipal code.
Yes.
Got it. Wonderful. Beautiful.
And of course, one of the things that when we do finally pass this, there will be frequently answered questions provided. There will be the types of examples that will help people. I would have hoped, at the end of this, that we could have, you know, workshops, be able to assist those who have less resources to be able to understand the law and be able to implement it.
Absolutely. As a spoiler alert, there's reference in the executive director's report to a new education position that we will be filling as of January 2nd. So we are very excited about a much more robust educational approach on all fronts, including educating about changes to the logging ordinance.
Okay. I appreciate the spoiler. All right. All in favor?
Oh, wait, did we second?
Yes.
Oh, second.
For sure, we're second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? All right, so moved. Wonderful. Okay, so now let's go back to the 501c3 exemptions.
As I said last time around, too, it's not something that I believe requires recusal, but the vast majority so far of the people speaking have had some of the most modest contributions that they probably get, but consistent ones. So I certainly respect and admire the organizations that are in the nonprofit sector. I do think that they are among sometimes the most persuasive of all of the people who speak, whether they have the resources or not. But I'm also very much concerned that they be treated as if they have the power, which I truly believe they do. And if they do have that power to speak, I think that they should be within the traditional lobbying and advocacy regulations of the city. I greatly appreciate the coming together on almost all of the issues by the nonprofit organizations who have spoken and giving us an option. I also greatly appreciate what staff has done in terms of removing the government funding provision and the other work they have to try and expand the exemption to relieve those organizations of anything that would be a bar to their continuing to speak. The list of all of what is a direct communication, I think, covers most of what people are concerned about. But I, you know, again, understand that it's a lot easier to be exempt than have to figure it all out. Can you speak to option five? I gotta put staff on the zone of explaining to us. If we'd had it a little sooner, it would have been a lot easier, I know, for staff. But tell us what you might have as an objection to option five.
Well, I can point out just maybe some points which would need to be clarified if this is the route the commission wanted to go. There are certain terms in here, certain activities that are not in our language. For example, terms like educational would probably need to be either defined in some way, because that could be kind of a broad overreaching term that
could
encompass.
To say, to educational particularly, when you looked at what I think was extraordinarily helpful when you were giving us some kind of a definition of the nonprofits, we have educational does have a very different threshold in terms of dollars, as do, of course, hospitals.
Right. In another area that is at least a difference, we have terminology that says created primarily for, and this kind of goes back to what was discussed in the October meeting for, you know, possible for-profits or other types of individuals trying to create nonprofits to, you know, get the exemption or circumvent the law in some way. When we have that language for primarily created for, you know, it's not a nonprofit or an entity that was created strictly for advocacy. That's kind of under the cape of a 501c3. So there is terminology like that to make it specific. But when it comes to whether it's option one, two, three, or four of ours, those are, I would like to clarify, and I mentioned this in my opening, these are not mutually exclusive. So, you know, it is possible to have one with, in conjunction with another, one option in conjunction with another option, which option five theoretically does in a way, but there are certain areas like that that would need additional clarification. If you're asking my opinion right off the bat.
If gross receipts of less than 2.5 million, we have a report here about a median revenue, so you really don't know if how far on the other 50% we go up or down.
Right. These numbers are just to kind of give you an area to kind of start the discussion. But yeah, you're right. These are median numbers. You know, when we look at educational institutions or hospitals, we're obviously in the millions. And this is statewide. We don't have the numbers for the county broken down this way. The other set of numbers that we did provide were who are registered in Los Angeles County. Looking at the National Center of Charitable Statistics, the data they provided for 2015, there were 23,000 organizations that filed, nonprofit organizations that filed tax returns. Of those, approximately 41% filed a Form 990N. A Form 990N, just for those who don't know, are for nonprofit organizations that have less than $50,000 in receipts. A Form 990EZ is for an organization that files less than $200,000 in gross receipts. So they don't have that data available for each Form 990EZs. I'm sorry, you're probably getting lost on all these 990s. But for Form 990Ns, approximately 41% of those nonprofits that filed returns in Los Angeles County filed a 990N. So for example, they would fall under option four exemption. So we can, I am personally comfortable saying that well over, just with option four alone, well over half of the nonprofits in Los Angeles County would be completely exempt, no questions asked. So that's kind of a breakdown of the two set of numbers.
For the woman, I'd like to hear other comments.
Okay. I'll say that I understand that you know, figuring out how to clarify educational, as someone who has and does work in the nonprofit sector, I know that it's a way to distinguish between being an advocacy organization. It's not meant to represent an organization like an institution that is educational. So I think it's meant to bring people in and help them understand their rights or the environmental factors around them. So I'm just trying to figure out, I'm thinking like, what is the, how do we reduce that even further so that it doesn't feel too broad to, but I also think that, you know, if we were to have something like a gross receipts cap, looking at budgets, that would then exempt larger organizations of the exemption. So we wouldn't, you know, this wouldn't apply to a large educational institution because those institutions are out, so their budgets are far exceed any kind of exemption. And so I just want to clarify that what I would support is, as you pointed out, Mr. Tarzi, like none of this is has to be in either or, that I would suggest that we adopt the, you know, both parts of the language and you know, one, having the gross receipts of less than 2.5 million and providing, you know, assistance such as food, clothing, shelter, not one to be exclusive of another. So I don't know, Commissioner Ornan, if there's any one of the exemptions based on budget that you would feel comfortable. I mean, maybe we further, like, let's break it down again. If you're comfortable with that language yet, or not.
I think one of the ways, if you were working, it doesn't matter which one we're working on, I think staff would be happy to have for free out of there, right? Because staff, if you were working on five, you'd don't need, I thought we were going to, we take that out anyway, right? We got that out, so that's out.
Okay.
And educational, if you're talking about, if the intent here is to have, to help the disadvantaged, the community that you're talking about, you wouldn't have to have the word educational, which raises ambiguity and starts us thinking about educational, my UC system, right? I would, if you were working off option five, I'd take out educational as raising ambiguity. Mm-hmm. And because you've already got, there was legal there, so, you know, that's helping to educate people, I hope.
But what if it's not legal, right?
Right.
What if it's just talking about, I think it was Ms. Wong was talking about how, you know, they're a church or a religious organization that's in the community talking about, you know, what are some of the effects of oil drilling, that there's no, it doesn't seem like that would be encompassed in this. It's not legal, it's not occasional.
Just one thing to point out is if the purpose of an organization is to educate constituents, mm-hmm. then that doesn't qualify as something that would be regulated under the lobbying law. It's when you're, when it would be educating, when it's advocating, to
right,
use
right,
your
right.
term, with city officials who can make decisions.
So it's technically moot. Like it's unnecessary, is what you're saying.
Yes, however, qualifying them as saying that someone who provides those assistance, that assistance to constituents exclusively
right.
qualifies them for an exemption is a question.
So what if the organization was an educational and advocacy organization and their gross receipts were less than X? Would they then, but they would, it would trigger it, right, if educational wasn't a part of this? Is that accurate?
If educational was not a part of the list, it was taken out of option five,
mm-hmm.
Then they, I don't think that they would qualify as an exempt organization.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
So I disagree. Can we work through this?
Yeah.
As far as option five, one provides assistance such as food, clothing, shelter, childcare, health, legal, vocational relief, and other similar assistance to disadvantaged people. Can we agree on that?
I think that
if information?
Informational?
Is that?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm comfortable. staff, please weigh in if you think.
I do very much value your deliberations and your considerations of it in such length. I do have some reservations in terms of how people would comply when you use terms such as educational or informational, because I think especially community-based organizations, for all the good they do, and please understand that it is not staff's belief that they need to even justify the good work that they do in the community, because of course they do that. But when we use terms as informational or educational, as being very broad, and using those to determine whether they should be exempt in having to either register or disclose, I think we run the danger of having them even having trouble in or difficulty in trying to comply. Because I think any organization can make the justification, what we do is educational,
right.
or what we do is informational. So I just want to avoid any type of confusion as we proceed here.
But what about environmental justice? Because that's, I feel like that's what they, right? And it had to do with, it did have to do with health, but it also had to, right? So then it's a little bit more, you know, the definition is more narrow than educational. I think the questions she was raising, for me, you know, like that these things that were happening in a community seemed to be causing cancer, right? That it was
Well, I mean, that organization, it would seem to me, one of the issues that we have here is many of the environmental justice organizations are, not many of, but some are very well funded, some are not funded at all.
Right.
I mean, basically there's not an executive director or anything, it's almost entirely a volunteer. So the way five is being written, or any way we mix and match, if the environmental justice one that you were talking about, I think certainly didn't have receipts of more than 2.5 million.
Right, right, right.
So they would be exempt.
Okay.
In that situation, and I do think 2.5 million is pretty high. But I know you gave it to us as option three. I think that one would be exempt, right? I mean,
like
if it is below, yeah, if that's what the commission decides, where it's this
right,
two-tiered
right.
exemption, and they are under 2.5 million.
So you have given us, as you said, four options of which we can mix and match. So this would be, I mean, here is five, but you, option three is part of option five, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Right,
right, right, right. And so let's stay, I get the feeling that my fellow commissioners would really like the 2.5 and they're not interested in dropping it.
Well, I think since we've got input from several different organizations and even the ones who were very small, as well as the larger ones, like our representative of Sierra Club, they all seem to feel comfortable with that. So I was taking that input into account.
Right, I agree. And organizations that were larger, like Liberty Co., who are partnering with the smaller organizations when they're coming and advocating on behalf of the smaller organizations seems to be a good representation of what our path are going to be.
Okay. So we've got part of our task done,
okay.
I think. And then it goes to the providing assistance. If we kept educational out, I'm just wondering, do we need the definition of what kinds of assistance people give?
That's a suggestion, the way it's written.
Yeah, I think it was to expand upon the direct basic assistance to disadvantaged.
No, let me look at the original language again one more time.
And I was going to note that from a technical perspective, the way this is drafted is that the list, if you would like the list to be exclusive, then I would modify it a little bit. Instead of saying assistance such as, I would say it provides food, clothing, legal, and other similar assistance, because the way that this is drafted, it could be read to say that any kind of assistance that you provide gets you in the ballpark. The other thing, and just as an anecdote, and I, again, as Mr. Tarzu pointed out, this is information data for the entire state, not necessarily Los Angeles, but we've noted that according to the California Association of Nonprofits, the only nonprofits in the state, the only 501c3s in the state that would have an operating budget or gross receipts of higher than $2.5 million are hospitals and higher education institutions. Whether how well that extrapolates into Los Angeles is, you know, we don't know.
So I'm sorry. Can you repeat what you said about number one, provides assistance, knock out such as, and just say provides assistance like?
Yes. So the way this is drafted, it essentially means provides assistance to disadvantaged people at a significantly below market rate,
mm-hmm.
because the list of the types of assistance
mm-hmm.
are suggestive and not limiting. right? So if the goal is to say, we're talking only food, shelter, housing, education, environmental justice, whatever that list is, I would modify this so that it's not a such as, but this is the list.
Okay. So just provides food, clothing, shelter, childcare, health, legal, vocational, et cetera. So we don't need to even say assistance, right? We're providing these things. Oh, I guess it could be assistance. Provides assistance in obtaining.
It would be very easy just to say these, take out assistance such as, and say provides food, clothing, shelter, that list, and other, it even includes other similar assistance to disadvantaged But Mr. Okay. Tarzi's question about whether it should be an organization primarily formed for that purpose is a good one. The way the exemption currently reads is that you are primarily formed for that purpose. It's not that you provide one meal and you're in.
Yes.
Yeah.
Good. Great.
So,
okay, so we need to add a three. So if an organization formed primarily to, yeah, agreed, yes.
And we would still want to have what is in the original language. You really like seeing the sausage man. we do have to have the language that it applies to the organization's employees and.
Yes.
Board members,
yes.
Still. I mean, we have to have that language because otherwise it's just the organization.
Yes.
So,
right. Okay. So we do want to agree.
Yeah,
right.
So and it's,
do
that's at the bottom of option
or
five.
Or we could add. Oh, it is.
Yeah.
It is.
Oh, okay.
Oh,
sorry.
Great. Okay, we have an opinion of.
Sorry. Yeah, that's
okay. Now to go back one more time on this 2.5 million, you gave us another figure. That was in San Francisco. Tell us what you just told us again on the 2.5 million.
Yes, there is data that was put together. It's 2014 data, and it was put together in terms of the entire state, not just Los Angeles or Los Angeles County. It was done by the California Association of Nonprofits, and according to them, the median revenue for a public 501c3 would only exceed $2.5 million in gross receipts if the organization was a hospital or a higher educational
right.
institution.
Oh, those are the figures that we yes. talked about before. I thought maybe you had another one that just said how many. I guess the. I don't have any real sense from those how many actually, except for the very largest of our nonprofits, would actually be at the 2.5. We don't know.
Mr. Tarzi put on a valiant effort to try to find more detailed information, and it was not readily available.
I just wonder if we are missing something if we go as high as 2.5 million. But we have the ability to work things out even again if we feel things are not being handled appropriately. So I know we want to reach a unanimity if we can and. I do not object to 2.5 million.
Okay. And are we ready to vote?
Just a minute. Let me be sure I've got this right. Because this is an or, this isn't an and.
Right.
So any organization, that means any 501c3, even if they don't do any of this, and they still only have 2.5 million, they're going to be exempt.
Correct.
So if it's less than 2.5 million, they are exempt without the criteria listed in Part 1.
So...
In that regard...
Can someone come up with a hypothetical that would scare me?
That's a problem.
It got a nonprofit, it still has to have some charitable effort. But is there something that's excluded from here and still could be charitable that we would think is someone that ought to be non-exempt?
I could speak in this. We kind of touched on this towards the end of the meeting in October on how these type of organizations are run. Obviously, a nonprofit and a for-profit have to be separate with regard to accounts and things of that nature. I believe President Levinson brought that up. You know, a blanket exemption like this could present a potential loophole. We did look into it. There is some gray area in this. I know the American Bar Association, they advise that a substantial majority of a nonprofit organization not have a relationship with a for-profit, but there still can be members on a nonprofit board from a for-profit. There are several law firms that are experts in nonprofit law, much smarter than me, and they also, there can be some relationship, obviously not a direct one, but some gray area between a for-profit and a nonprofit. And then when it comes to the IRS's permitting nonprofits engaging in lobbying activity or advocacy, they do cap that starting at 20%. So if you're looking for that kind of information on potential pitfalls or negatives, a $2.5 million blanket exemption would be $500,000.
That's not accurate.
At potentially lobbying activity. So it would be a substantial increase, whatever that number is, of the $5,000 general threshold, if that's what you're looking for.
That's not accurate as to budget size for that percentage.
Can we call back the public comment person to make a response?
If you do, you have to allow other people to do the same.
Other people who wish to do that?
Should
we do
that's
that?
That's fine. Yeah. Can we take a brief 5-minute break? It's 11.
Okay.
Okay. So it's 11:04. Let's come back at 11:10.
Yeah. Oh. Do you need to wait?
Okay. I'll just take this opportunity to, again, as we're getting to the end of our lobbying meeting. Yeah, that's a good idea. That's fine because we're in mid, right? I'll just take this opportunity to thank the commission staff for all of their hard work over the last year, and I really enjoy being a part of this commission, and I appreciate, being a civilian, not knowing all of this information, how forthcoming, and what kind of a partnership there is, not just with the commission staff, but also with the community coming forward today and really being supportive in helping us. This issue item in particular has been a long time coming, and it's slow progress. But I think to see the way that the community and the staff and the commissioners have come together to sort of trudge through it together
is inspiring and exciting. And so I just, you know, will say thank you. I hope that everybody has a very well-deserved holiday break.
Thank you very much. That's very kind. We really appreciate it. And we really value the expertise that you bring to the work that we do here and the thoughtfulness that you give to all of the considerations. And I agree with you. It's fantastic. We often have issues where we get zero input from the public. So it's really nice to have a change and have some real engagement over an issue that we're grappling with. So we're glad for that.
Yeah, it's nice to be in a, you know, in what feels like a conversation. And I think former Commissioner Pat would be proud of the decorum with how this has been handled. It's been entirely productive and respectful. And I, you know, again, given sort of some of the climate in the world around us, it's nice to be a part of that. Hello.
Sorry about that. We could pass out all the nice comments that you didn't have to hear. Like,
I'm sure it wasn't
that. All of them, but you missed it, so too bad. Down to issue item number 8. I think that Mr. Orden wanted to ask if Ms. Renoir would come up and clarify.
Yeah, but just the issue on lobbying the exemption. I think you had a comment just to, more to yourself, but I think it would be helpful, and I got council's approval to bring you up as long as I allowed anybody else.
Everyone else
wanted
is invited
to come up.
Too.
So
just on that smaller issue of the 20% mm-hmm. limitation on lobbying and what that truly meant in working.
Okay, sure, thank you. So 501c3 organizations are, the legal standard for them is that they're only allowed to do an insubstantial amount of lobbying, and depending on the organization itself and the choices it makes, whether it's a church or house of worship, and in some cases the size of its budget, what that really means is anywhere between approximately 5% and 20%. The 20% only applies to organizations who are of a smaller budget level, 500,000 and below. So an organization who is at a budget level of 2.5 million, it's a sliding scale downward, and so it's somewhere between 20 and 5%. Let's see, I think on my phone here it says that it is 225,000 plus 5% of the exempt purpose expenditures over 1.5 million. So suffice to say, it's less than 20%, probably, you know, down somewhere down to 5%. One other thing, since you called me up, if we're working towards language, 501c3 is primarily formed to provide food, clothing, et cetera, or other similar assistance. Instead of and, I think because of the way you changed the language there, you would probably want to change that and to an or, so that somebody doesn't have to provide all those types of assistance.
Right.
For that, and we thank you for your deliberation on this.
You've
been very helpful.
Thank
you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you
too. Anyone else want to talk?
Me.
I think they would raise their hands.
I think.
Well,
he wants to.
Oh, okay. Hi, Adrian Riskin. I'd just like to say that if you guys are actually going to seriously consider a cap, 2.5 million or any other amount that will exempt all 501c3s under that, I think it's imprudent to approve anything before you know how many 501c3s that would cover. It just worries me that you might be exempting all of them or 90% of them. At this point, nobody knows. So I urge you at least to get some facts on that before you go ahead with a blanket exemption based on a cap.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I think I have a better, a little bit better sense of, I don't have the overall numbers, and I think the comment, public comments as to not knowing those numbers is not insignificant. Certainly, I realize now also that it is important to have the definitions, because there are organizations that are 501c's that clearly have gross receipts of less than much more than 2.5 million, and I think I've started thinking of Union Rescue or Red Cross or others like that. So clearly, you must have the fact that it is assistance for, mm-hmm. for those definitions. So clearly, we need both of them. I do still think, and maybe we could compromise somewhat on the 2.5 million, and reduce it. San Francisco uses 200,000. I mean, so there's started there. If we reduced it somewhat, maybe down to just even 200,000, and be able to have agreement.
I think that would be too low, because most bar associations, I could speak for my own, that is a nonprofit, that's about what our budget is. I mean, I know it sounds like
You're not a C3 though.
Yes.
Instead of a C4.
No, we are a C3. Well, my bar association is. So I think that may be a little. I understand your concern. You think 2.5 is too high, but I think that's a little low, because then you're getting the difference between hiring a lawyer. I mean, of course, everybody has to have a CPA or somebody with that background in order to file the taxes. But now, still at that level, with those organizations at that level may or may not have an executive director. So I think that would be overly burdensome. I think the threshold should be much higher.
Yeah, I think the 2.5 million was what was presented last time, was that it's at that point that somebody has an executive director and some kind of CFO or legal counsel who can navigate this stuff for them, and that was the reasoning behind it. I also know that I think it's 2 million is the number when organizations are federally trigger audits at certain levels. So maybe that feels more comfortable, 2 million.
I would feel if we could do that. The other part is our organization, the staff is set up, and if you go back to your informational part, it's amazing how many people contact the Ethics Commission. It really is set up to give that kind of advice and the kind of assistance of whether they fall into these categories. And in fact, even our prior agenda items, we have seen that we take into account the fact that people don't try and call us and ask those questions. So I think there's a lot more information and a lot more ability for non-lawyers, who are also very smart, to be able to get information. So I would feel much more comfortable if we at least dropped it to the 2 million. And then we will continue to monitor this, and obviously it goes even further up to the city council. And there'll be more information brought forward at that time if it needs to be dropped further.
Okay. So should we take a vote? Okay. So I make a motion to adopt option number 5 with the language reading. An organization formed primarily to provide food, clothing, shelter, childcare, health, legal, vocational relief, or other similar assistance to disadvantaged people at a significantly below market rate, or has a gross receipt of less than $2 million,
This is exemption also applies to the organization's employees, board members, while engaged in official duties. This exemption does not apply when an organization is seeking funding, property, or permit from the state on its own. Is everybody comfortable with that?
Just okay. To be clear, you're talking about 501c3.
That's correct. Yes, yes. So specifically for the 501c3 exemption.
And the language, and the language is
correct. Right. It's yes, beginning.
I second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Wow. Guys.
Can that be on the record?
All right. Wonderful. Well, we're not done.
No, we have
informational items. So maybe
for those of you who think you ought to leave, you should just look online for.